Good morning. Happy St. Margaret's Day. My name is Richard Weinberg, and I have the privilege of serving as the rector of St. Margaret's. On behalf of all of us who call this place their spiritual home, welcome. If this is your first or 100th or 200th time at St. Margaret's, know that you are welcome. And in particular, if it is your first time joining us on the day when this parish celebrates its annual feast day, where we acknowledge and remember, give thanks for the witness of Margaret of Scotland, our patron, we do things a little differently and a little kind of all the stops are pulled out. And so as we gather this morning, I want to acknowledge all of you who are looking fabulous in red and plaid and whatever you chose to put on this morning. All are welcome. And those of you who might be watching online, as we begin, I actually want to invite you to stand up, and we're going to go outside. The bagpiper is going to lead us in a procession around our block. One time a year, we send this clarion call out to our neighborhood, acknowledging our presence, giving thanks to God for the gifts of this place. And then we'll come back inside and continue with our service. So welcome this morning. I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you. Blessed be God, source of all being, incarnate Word and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's name, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you those secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, really magnify your holy name, through Jesus our Savior. Amen.
With you.
God, you called your servant Margaret to an earthly throne that she might advance your heavenly reign, and gave her zeal for your church and love for your people. Mercifully grant that we who commemorate her this day may be fruitful in good works and attain the glorious crown of your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Proverbs. A capable woman, who can find? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her partner trusts in her, and they will have no lack of gain. She does her partner good and not harm all the days of her life. She opens her hand to the poor, and she reaches out her hands to the needy. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her happy, her partner too, and they praise her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears God is to be praised. Give her a share in the fruit of her hands, and let her works praise her in the city gates. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
Amen. A reading from the first letter to Timothy. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings should be made for everyone, for rulers and all who are in high positions, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God. There is also one mediator between God and humankind, Jesus Christ, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
At the appointed time, the human one will come in glory, escorted by all the angels, and will sit on the throne of glory with all the nations gathered below. Then the human one will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and will put the sheep at the right hand and the goats to the left. Then the ruler will say to those at the right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Abba God, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer, "When was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the ruler will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then the ruler will say to those at the left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "When was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then the ruler will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Christ.
In the name of the living God, amen. Please be seated. One of the most entertaining and, I'd say, theologically rich television shows I've watched in the past couple of years is called The Good Place. Any Good Place fans? Yeah, I'm seeing some reactions here. The Good Place, if you don't know, started airing in 2016, and it wrapped up its final season just last year. The premise is that Eleanor, this kind of anti-heroine protagonist, has died through a freak shopping cart accident, and she finds herself dead in this kind of idyllic utopian suburbia where all the lawns are manicured, and she's given this house that meets all of her needs, and even when she wants to say a curse word, it won't come out because it's the good place. And yet, something's off because Eleanor knows deep down that she ain't good. She's a bad person. And she learns that there was this point system that somehow went awry. There's a point system in which she discovers that every single thing that humans do on the face of the earth is either given a positive point or a point is taken away. And when we die, the tally of where we land ends up taking us to the good place or the bad place. Eleanor, the protagonist, seems to have taken the place of another Eleanor who wound up in the bad place. She spends the entire first season trying to not be found out as an imposter. The reason I say it's rich theologically is because it kind of plays on the tropes of faith, I believe, that is still very much alive today. In fact, it's a kind of medieval version of Christianity that in many ways was part of the church culture that I grew up in still. I think is prevalent in a lot of Christendom still today, in which we're taught that the goal of life is to get into heaven, and that God is there, omnipresent, measuring up all the good deeds we do, which are righteous things, and all the bad things we do, which are sins. And when we die, the tally will either bring us to heaven or condemn us to hell. I want to explore this morning how this kind of theology is not only problematic, but it's also very terrifying. I remember being terrified as a child, fixated on the idea that God was going to judge me for every little thing that I did. And I think the reason that so many of us are squeamish about judgment is because of the ways it has been used as a weapon by certain Christians across time and space to this day who have decided that they know which are the balance of good deeds that attain salvation and which are the sins that condemn us no matter what. And this is both problematic but terrifying to be driven by such a faith. In fact, this was the kind of theology that was very much alive in the day of our patron, Margaret of Scotland, the infamous Hungarian princess who wanted very much, most of all, to be a nun, to be a religious person who led a life in the convent. She was raised by Benedictines, but fate would have it that she was called to be a queen and marry Malcolm, the king of Scotland. Yet she tried to live her life as one who was modeled after the gospel passage that we just read from Matthew. A biographer of hers, Eileen Dunlap, the only scholarly modern biography that I've found of Margaret's, if you know of another, I'd love to know. There's a lot of kind of hagiography, but the only scholarly work I know of hers actually makes a really strong argument that Margaret would have lived in fear of this passage in particular. Because Margaret was driven by the Gospels in her life, but also by the rule of Saint Benedict. She was raised by Benedictine monks, and so the rule of Saint Benedict would have also been as important as the Gospels to her way of life. And Saint Benedict's rule of life includes the 7 corporal works of mercy, which are the exact things that are mentioned in today's gospel passage. To feed the hungry, to give drink to the thirsty, to welcome the stranger, to clothe the naked, to take care of the sick, and to visit those in prison. Margaret modeled her life after these practices by getting proximate to those who were suffering. And so I want to invite us to move beyond this medieval theology of focusing on judgment, to see what this text, how the Spirit is speaking to us through this text today. That means we need to hold intention and move past this sense of guilt that many of us walk around with regards to judgment. We need to acknowledge and then move past the way that judgment has been weaponized against so many. Because the truth is that judgment is part of our tradition. It is part We say in the ancient creed that Christ will return to judge the living and the dead, and that's exactly what's being depicted in Matthew's gospel this morning. So said positively, judgment is good news. It is good news that God is going to judge us because it means that God cares. God cares about the evil that we have inflicted upon one another as humankind. God cares that Ahmaud Arbery and countless black lives have been killed. God cares about the lives, the most number of transgender people who have been murdered on record in our lives was this year. Today begins Transgender Week of Remembrance and Awareness. God cares that we continue to perpetuate binary understandings of gender identity and shun those who don't fit into neat boxes. God cares about this society which we're sustaining, which still somehow allows those experiencing homelessness and material poverty to not have access to the systems that enable them to flourish on their own. Yet, there is enough for all to go around. God cares when the church abuses its power, when it excludes people and fails to repent of the sins of our past, our complicity in chattel slavery and colonialism. Jesus will return to judge the living and the dead, and in the balance and fullness of time, things will be put right. Judgment is good news for all victims of injustice and evil. And it's good news for all of us who thirst after justice and righteousness. Our patron, Margaret of Scotland, I have to say, more than any other parish that I've been a part of, aligns so well with the culture of our parish, meaning we as a parish match perfectly our patron. Her legacy is so aligned with our legacy. We are driven by the practices in today's gospel passage of caring for those among us who are sick, of nourishing those who are hungry and thirsty, of clothing those who don't have clothing, welcoming those who've experienced unwelcome in so many spaces in our world, helping even returning citizens to find a sense of belonging and purpose. And yet I want to say it's tempting to kind of tally up these acts of good deeds that we as a people are understandably proud of as a way of kind of earning our way to heaven. And it's tempting to look at the balance of our parish's legacy and our passion for social justice as a against, over and above, others who claim to follow Christ. You and I know that there's more nuance to it than that, though. I want you to notice a few things in today's text. Notice what Jesus says to the righteous. Though he separates the sheep from the goats, the righteous go on the right side, the unrighteous goats go on the left. And to the right, Jesus begins by saying, "Come. You that are blessed by my Abba, inherit the kingdom prepared for you." It turns out they didn't earn their way into the kingdom, because the kingdom is an inheritance. It's a gift. It's not something that's earned. In fact, it's not even exclusively for Christians. The whole passage begins by saying that it's all the people of the world, all the nations. That word nations, in the Greek, many argue, just means Gentiles, meaning it's not just Christians, but all people who do these things that inherit the kingdom of God. It doesn't mention a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. It doesn't mention baptism. It's addressed to the entire world. The other thing I want us to notice is that neither the sheep or goats, nor goats, the righteous nor unrighteous, knew what they were or weren't doing. Both respond, "Lord, when was it that we took care of you when you were sick, fed you when you were hungry? When was it that you were a stranger and we didn't welcome you, naked and we didn't clothe you?" They didn't realize. They didn't realize how it could be that they wound up in the group that they're in. And Jesus, of course, answers, "Whenever you did or did not do one of these things, you did or didn't do it to me, my own self, because I am most alive and present in the lives of those who he called the least of these, members of my family." So if it's not about earning our way to heaven, what does this text mean? For me, I think it means that the sheep and the goats didn't know, but we have the benefit of Matthew's gospel in which we do know. We're given this glimpse of what it's all about. Thanks to Matthew, we know what is to come. We have the benefit of knowing that what we do or don't do to the least of these, we do or don't do to Christ himself. God cares about what we do or don't do. But the good news is that not a single one of us is either as good as or as bad as the things we do or don't do. The point is, I think, that salvation is offered to all. The kingdom of God is an inheritance, a gift that's on offer. Said in other ways, my prayer for you and for me on a daily basis and as we anticipate this next year of our parish life is that as we await this final end of Christ's judgment and Christ's return, that we're motivated less by this tally approach of good and bad and motivated more by responding to this, what we call amazing grace, that has already, is right now in this very moment, this very morning as you sit here, and will continue to be on offer day after day, across time and space, right here, right now. Salvation is being offered, and Christ is preparing a place at the table for us all. Happy St. Margaret's Day. Amen.
Please stand as you're able to join me in this affirmation of faith in the words of the ancient creed. We believe in God, the creator of all life and beauty, who blesses our journey. We believe in Jesus Christ, who lived as a friend and savior to all he met as he traveled, and who ate and laughed, wept and celebrated with them in love. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who rides on the gentle breeze, who strengthens our bindings, and who offers hope eternal. We believe in the Church, which stands open to all travelers and bears witness to the everlasting love of God. Amen. Please be seated.
Everybody, My name is Annie Elliott, and on behalf of this year's stewardship committee, I want to thank you all so much for taking the past several weeks to reflect on your lives, on your relationship to St. Margaret's, on the blessings in your life, and to discern whether and how you feel called to give this year to our stewardship campaign, A Place at the Table. So thank you especially to all of you who have had a chance so far to go online and pledge. And for those of you who have not yet had a chance, have no fear, because we have intended giving cards here today. And I invite you at this time during the hymn to complete one of these cards and place them in the basket up here. The amount you give really doesn't matter. We would love to have everyone's participation, to have everyone share in this experience. So thank you all very much. I have some here. Tim is making a ruckus at the back. He has some cards. I have some cards. So after I put the mic down, please just raise your hand if you need one, and we'll come around and hand you a card and a pen. And then during the hymn, please feel free to come up. We invite you and place your card in the basket. Thank you all again so much. It was really such an honor to work on the campaign this year. Thank you.
Thank you. For the Nacotchak people on whose unceded ancestral lands we worship today.
We thank you, Lord Christ.
For the Church Universal, of which this building is a visible symbol.
We thank you, Lord Christ.
For your presence whenever two or three are gathered in your name. For this place where we may be still and know that you are God.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the fulfilling of our desires and petitions as you see best for us.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For our past and a vision of the future that lies ahead.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the gift of the Holy Spirit and new life in baptism. For the pardon of our sins when we have fallen short of your glory.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the Holy Eucharist in which we have a foretaste of your eternal reign.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the blessing of our vows and the crowning of our years with your goodness.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the faith of those who have gone before us and for our encouragement by their perseverance. For all the benefactors of this place who have died in the peace of Christ and are at rest.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
For the kinship of all your saints and especially for Margaret, our patron.
Thank you, Lord Christ.
And continuing with prayers submitted by members of our community, by Jane for Warren Mace, who is now in the loving arms of God. By Jane for the dedication and work of the Altar Guild and Flower Guild and all who kept our worship space welcoming and joyful. From Walter for the soul of beloved friend and colleague Petra Mayer, who died suddenly this weekend, may she rest in peace. By Carter for Peter's health. By Jane for those confirmed at the cathedral yesterday, especially for Damon Clements. For Michelle Tapia, by David, for Gloria Quito Lewis, Peter Quito, and Modesta Gonzalez, by Miranda in thanksgiving for the live stream team, by Miranda prayers for Isabel as she prepares for surgery next week, by Isabel asking your prayers for Guy, our dear friend in France who is recovering from a recent heart attack, also asking prayers for the family and friends of Petra who passed away suddenly this weekend. And then finally, in thanksgiving for Sandy and blessings for Tyson.
O God, from living and chosen stones, you prepare an everlasting dwelling for your majesty. Grant that in the power of the Holy Spirit, those who serve you here may always be kept within your presence. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
Another good morning to all of you. It is such a joy-filled day. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I am feeling it, and I hope you are too. We're at the point in our service when we are transitioning to this table, and I want you to know as we gather and prepare this sacred meal that you are welcome at it. This table doesn't belong to this parish. This table doesn't belong to the Episcopal Diocese of Washington or to the Episcopal Church. This table belongs to God. And all who seek a deeper relationship with God are welcome to be fed at this table. We're serving these days due to COVID, old school wafers, which we also have available in gluten-free variety. If you need that, please make your need known. And if for whatever reason receiving the bread of Holy Communion is not part of your practice, we still invite you to be a part of this celebration. And if you come forward during the distribution and cross your arms like this, we'd be honored to give you a prayer of blessing instead. And now, while we have ingathered your pledges of generosity for the coming year, as is our custom each week, we pause as we prepare to set this table to offer back something of the abundance that God has given us. And so during the offertory, there will be a passing of the plate, and you'll see a link in the chat box to give today. And if you are our guest, please know that you're under no obligation to put anything in the plate or to click on the link. Instead, what I would love for you to do, if you are our guest, we're so blessed by your presence today, and there are these bright blue connect cards hanging on the ends of all the pews. There should be a pin nearby too. If you take this and let this be your offering, we would love to know who you are and how we might contact you. And there'll be a link in the chat box to fill out a virtual version of this card. And for anyone who chooses to give, know that it is your giving that makes possible our mission. We thank you for your generosity. We invite you to walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Oh,
God be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give our thanks to the Most High, our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and foundation of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with all the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we fail to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word made flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, Christ revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, Christ triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into everlasting heritage of your children, that with Blessed Margaret and all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray each in our own language. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on and rose again for you, and feed on him in your hearts through faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
God, our Redeemer, who inspired Margaret to witness to your love and to work for the coming of your kingdom, may we who in this sacrament share the bread of heaven be fired by your Spirit to proclaim the gospel in our daily living, and never to rest content until your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And we now call forth all those commissioned to take the Eucharist out into the world, to members of our community who cannot be with us here. We call Tim and, thank you, we call Carolyn, who is going to Kimberly Rankin, Helen, who is going to see Edith Scott, and Tim Green, who's going to see Diana Wright. We send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you may go, that you may share with us in the Christ's body and blood.
Please be seated. Yesterday, we welcomed six newly confirmed or received members into our church, into our communion, and as members of St. Margaret's. We want to present them to you. If you all can come on up now, it's your moment. So help me read. Aggie was received. Aggie Mannix, Sully Russ as well. Maggie, Margaret, and Jerry. Jessica Ray Church. It's amazing y'all are actually in the order that I had these cards. Rhonda Williford was confirmed, and our own Damon Clements was confirmed. We have gifts for you too. You can sort that out. Please go ahead. Let us pray for them. Thank you, God, for the gift of your grace given to us through sacramental rites. Thank you for Aggie, Sally, Maggie, Jessica, Rhonda, and Damon, who have said yes to you and made this commitment publicly in your church. Help us to nurture them, come alongside them, as they and we together grow in love of you and of one another through Christ our Savior. Amen.
We also have for them books of common prayer, as well as...
If they already had a BCP, they're getting a surprise book.
Aggie, also is perfect order, Sally. Maggie. Yeah. Jessica. Rhonda. And Damon. Thank you.
And now is the time of announcements.
Hi, I'm Kathy Connolly.
And I'm Patty Nickerson.
We're members of your elected vestry. We'd ask all vestry members to stand and be recognized. It is wonderful, borrowing from the language of our sequence hymn, to see so many sweet expressions on so many faces today, both here in the sanctuary, notwithstanding our masks, and online. We invite you to come to the vestry after the service with any comments or questions.
Well, I guess there's just one reminder about the Journaling Through Advent sign up. I think there's still time if you want to do it. The first session will take place on November 16th through Advent. The theme is looking forward and turning back.
And look in your bulletin for all other announcements for ways to connect and participate here at St. Margaret's. Thank you.
And do join us on the patio after the service. John Payne is providing shortbread and tea sandwiches. And there's coffee.
May the blessing of God be upon you. In the name of God, the Creator, God, the Redeemer, and God, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
us go forth in the name of Christ.